to the final day of the Route de Sud. We were climbing yesterday, super dramatic as well. The push on from Contador, who distanced Quintana on the descent. Quintana taking it perhaps a little bit more sensibly than Contador did. Alberto saying that he was doing it for his team, it worked so incredibly hard for him. As a result, his gap at the line plus the bonus means that he leads this race by 17 seconds. Great performance by Roger Latour, Pierre Rogier, for AG2R Le Mondial. Great prospect he is. He leads the young riders classification. And indeed, there he is, 41 seconds down. Rosetto and Sepulveda, the only other riders under a minute down on Contador. Well, it is the orange jersey on the back of Alberto as we look down and see, yes, the yellow and blue of his team. Tinkoff Saxo doing most of the chasing. Why are they chasing? Well, they're kind of maintaining a gap, essentially, because Ricardo Vieira is in a 10-rider breakaway. You're looking at it right now. In fact, that is the back of Christian Mongier. And as we go through them right now, as you can see, that is Duarte, former junior world champion. Just passed by Becerra as well from Morias, who've been very, very handy here. Roman Ardi as well, also in this break, wearing the points jersey, which looks like it may well belong to him, especially if this break goes all the way. That's Monteguti out front. Matteo took the runner-up in the GP Camiori last year, the 31-year-old. It's a mixture of veterans and youngsters just riding through there. Francis Moret, who took the Trobro a couple of years ago, 34-year-old from Francis Dujer in the white. And just exchanging places with Pierrick Federigo as well. Coming through for Europe Car, Jérôme Cousin, the 26-year-old, runner-up in the Étoile Bessèges not that long ago. So a handy group, I think it's fair to say. Ricardo Vieira of Caio Rorel just sailing by as well. And the aforementioned Monteguti from AG2R Le Mondial. Francis Moret of Francis Dujer, then. Mongier from Cult Energy is up here. Becerra from Moraes Taldea. Romanardi, Federigo, Elfares, Cousin, Duarte, Vieira. They are your 10 men up the road with 65.9 kilometres to go. It's just under 2 minutes. And the best placed of them, as we mentioned, is Ricardo Vieira, 3 minutes and 9. Everyone else is much further away than that. And so they don't want the gap to get silly. But it's been hovering around 2 minutes for much of the day. It is, however, Brian Smith, a very capable breakaway group, this. And they've got a lot of power on board. How much of a worry are they?
Well, I don't think they're too much of a worry to Contador's team. The best place, as you said, for is the Caja Rural rider, Vieira, the 27-year-old from Portugal. He's sitting at 3 minutes and 9 seconds, but the size of the breakaway, 10 riders, is a good working group. 8 riders in every team that started this race, apart from a couple of teams that only sent 7 riders, and Cannondale, who's only sent 6 riders. So 10 riders, they should have a good chance to go all the way towards the finishing line. 16 teams in this Route du Sud. So the teams that have missed out in the breakaway, Tinkoff just riding at the front looking after Contador. Movistar, well, they're looking after the interest of Quintana.
They're busy, and I'm not surprised. The spin sprints, intermediate sprints up for grabs. Arde took the first of them, and they're just sort of rolling through them, as you can see, more or less. Arde taking one of the last points along the way, but it looks like he's going to get that green jersey, which is good news. Julian Elfares from Team Marseille 13. They've been pretty handy in this race. As you were saying, Brian, you've got some local races and French teams really want to shine brightly, but the breaks have really been graced by some of the more unusual teams for some of our viewers.
Yeah, normally you get in a lot of the third division teams, they come here to race. It's like in football, you know, any cup in any country, you get the smaller teams playing against the big teams, they always up their game. And it's the same here in cycling, that a lot of the smaller teams always come here and trying up their game. And normally they've got one or two good riders, and we've seen that already. We've seen Alfares. Alfares has ridden with Cofidis in the past, but you know, he's still full of fight. So it's good to see a mixture of teams. We've got 5 World Tour teams, 6 Pro Continental teams, and 5 Continental teams. So it's 16 teams. The teams that have missed out in the 10-man breakaway are Tinkoff and Movistar. They're looking after their GC contender. They're happy. Quintana looks happy with his performance yesterday. He's been out with a little bit of injury. He came back, and he's happy, and he was only distancing the descent yesterday because he wasn't wanting to take too many risks. The other teams that missed in the breakaway, Trone's team of Auburn 93, Radio Popular, the French Army team, and Cannondale Garmin. So they're the teams, the six teams that missed out. Why this break will stay, could stay away is most of the teams are represented in that breakaway, so one rider from each of the 10 teams. Tinkov and Movistar aren't interested in the stage because they're just looking after Contador and Quintana. But the thing is, the reason why this has been fast, the first hour was run off at an average of 45.6 kilometres, the second hour 44.3, so they're not hanging around. Tinkoff just want to keep it around 2 minutes because Vieira of Caharua was sitting at 3:09, so they're comfortable riding, so they'll ride as fast as the 10 riders in front will ride. But when you look further down, Auburn 93, are they going to chase for Trone? Do they have the firepower? I don't think they do. Neither does Radio Popular or the French Army team. Cannondale could bring it back, but they've only got six riders here in this race. So this is a great opportunity for the win to come from the breakaway today.
There we go. Auburn 93 will be kicking themselves, I'm afraid. They've had a pretty good race so far, but not today. They're not up there. Radio Popular Boa Vista as well have been reasonably active. Roman Hardy got himself in the break and picking up points in both of the intermediate sprints. They moved the second sprint, incidentally. Just caught it as we came on air by 5 kilometres, not quite sure why. But wide open highway they chose. And indeed, Hardy picking up the last of the points at the line as well. So looks like that points jersey is going to belong to him, especially if this, as predicted by Brian Smith, manages to go all the way. Welcome back. Just over 61 kilometres to go, and the gap absolutely solid by the looks of things at around the 2 minute mark. Decent pace being held by the men in the breakaway. There are 10 of them up the road. That's a pretty handy riders we've got along the way. Those, I guess, if you look down there, Paramaras, and we do have some veterans here, but Pierrick Federigo used to go extraordinarily well in the Tour de France, as I'm sure you know. Stage victories for him along the way. He's 36 years of age now, and still wanting to function at a reasonably high level. Everyone is today, it seems. They're creating their own breeze, not much of a wind around, which is good news, I guess, if that's not your sort of thing. So no real echelons today, but 28 Celsius. Brian, that's warm, and it bodes well for a nice, toasty Tour de France. Let's just hope the rain stays away from Utrecht and the north when we're up there, but it looks like you're going to have a pleasant time when you get on the road with your boys.
Yeah, it's and actually the just over race radio, it's saying it's actually pushed up to 30 degrees now, so it's warm out there, and you see a lot of the riders just unzipping their tops. They won't have any undervests on in warm conditions, but a lot of the clothing that, you know, these pro bike riders wear actually keep them cool. And you know, there's a fabric called Cold Black, because there's a lot of black in the peloton, and it actually has the adverse effect. Everybody thinks that you know, black clothing would make you feel, you know, make you warmer, because it absorbs the heat a little bit more than reflects it. But the clothing nowadays helps to keep the riders fairly cool.
Great performance yesterday by Tinkoff Saxo. And just telling the bike, get away, stop helping people. Come on, what are you doing? That's the camera bike being told off here.
In Colombian?
Yeah, in Colombian.
I don't want to mess with them.
Sign language is, you know, is there for everybody. Well, you know, he essentially doesn't want the brake to fail, and he believes that the former under-23 world champion Duarte has got a chance. He was king of the mountains in Luxembourg recently, the 29-year-old. Anyway, Colombia, not believing that some kind of assistance was being offered up there. Well, I guess it would have been. We're camera bike just getting a little bit too close for the Team Colombia's liking. Back he goes now, having delivered his message. But, yeah, interesting little view. Interesting yesterday as well, Brian, that Contador said that he had to take the win because his team had just done so much work, he wanted to pay them back.
Yeah, that's often the case, and we did mention at the time it was a lot of work all day, and Quintana says it's, as we say, Sorry for that. Mick Rogers was having trouble getting. Normally they have one of these vests they put on, but one of the most experienced riders in the peloton, in fact, probably the experienced peloton, made an error there and putting too many riders down his back and couldn't get it out. So Contador having to get his bidding from his teammate and push it out from his sweaty back.
What I suggest he does is when he opens the valve, if it's a twister, anyway, give it a little squirt first, otherwise you're going to get a bit of salt in there and it's not going to be his own. Michael Rogers, of course, did a great job to Bagnères de Luchon, a stage he knows very well, actually. He'd taken victory there in the Tour de France previously. But yeah, I think he was last man standing, wasn't he, for Contador, and he burnt them all out yet again. Contador himself, incidentally, saying that he feels less tired the more riding he's done. It was always the plan to ride the legs back in competition-wise. Of course, he's been doing plenty of training since the Giro d'Italia, but through Arc and Saint-Gaudens, and then go for it. Target day was Bagnères de Luchon, and he delivered. But good news for him in terms of his current physical state.
Certainly, both Contador and Quintana looked strong yesterday. I have to say that Latour did a great job in staying with them. But when you look at the level, you would expect Latour to be dropped from Contador and Quintana, especially when Contador was doing the accelerations. I think both of them have to be satisfied, but I wouldn't think that they would be overjoyed. Maybe the sensations in the legs would be okay. And I think Contador put in a brave face, because he wouldn't say that he was feeling a little fatigued in yesterday's stage. Exactly. So I thought he did. I didn't think he looked as zippy as he normally does. Quintana wasn't playing. He just wanted to stay with them. Got distance in the descent. There wasn't really much between them. It was just a few corners made the difference. 13 seconds in the end. I still think there's work to be done. Some zip needs to be put back into Contador's legs before the Tour de France. But it's a 3-week race. He'll be strong going into it. But I don't think it was an exhilarating performance by either Quintana or Contador yesterday. They're satisfied, but they've got some work to do.
There we are. It's hard to pick through the PR at the moment. But what is great news is that we've seen Froome functioning very, very well. Nibali looked a bit spare, I must say, in the Dauphiné, so he's got some ground to make up. But he's traditionally doesn't really turn it on until the whatever target race he has, and occasionally rides himself in during the event. So don't worry too much about Vincenzo Nibali. He's had bad form before. He had it in front of the Tour de France, in fact, last year, when he went on for victory, of course. And if you think, well, he only won it because Contador and Chris Froome got themselves injured on the cobble sections and in the inclement weather up there, well, think again, because quite frankly, the performance on the cobbles by Nibali, and we've got more cobbles this year, really badged him up as a superb performer. And when he won into Sheffield, it was almost cathartic. He basically binned all of the mal comments, I think it's fair to say, from his own team that had been talking him down and trying to encourage him, I guess, by criticism. It doesn't always work. Well, he did respond emphatically, and his team, of course, now trust him, despite the fact he's not this year, Nibali we're talking about, has not got the form on paper that he's had in the past. But nonetheless, no criticism this time by, and I guess they're just expecting him to do what he did last year. Do you think he can?
I think he'll be there and thereabouts, and if everybody stays upright, I think Froome and Contador, in fact, Froome is in the Pyrenees with his Team Sky teammates looking at the stages, so they're not too far away in this area of this race. But looking at it, you know, the big four, Froome, Quintana, Contador, Nibali, it's going to be a battle, and I think this is probably one of the most open Tour de France's we're going to see. We're going to see some great racing, and I hope that, unlike last year, and it wasn't the cobbles that made the difference, because Froome actually crashed before we hit the cobbles, but I just hope that the first week all the major contenders, all four of them, including Contador, who crashed in the descents, are still in there for the second half of the Tour de France, because it's going to be spectacular.
Mm. Yes, Froome, of course, did not crash actually on the cobbles, but he crashed because of them. There was a lot of skirmishing as they headed towards it, and dreadful weather as well, just nasty, grizzly conditions. And of course, a combination of factors brought him down, I'm afraid. He tried to ride on, as did Contador with a broken leg, you might remember. Contador went on to win the Vuelta. He's now won the Giro. Will it count in your mind as three in a row? Well, it will be three in a row, but will it be the Grand Slam in your head?
Yeah, I think so. Three in a row, yeah.
For me, okay. It's fair enough. Yeah, I agree with you entirely.
Yeah, it's not.
A lot of people say no, he's got to win them all in one season. I think back to back to back is good enough.
Yeah, I think that I would concur with you on that one, Carlton. It's okay. It's not in one year, and it's a big thing to do the Giro d'Italia, because it was hard, and then the Tour de France. But Nibali last year, just going back to your original question on. Last year, he was acting as if he was a defending champion. He was acting as if, like, you know, he was the favourite. And not many people get the option of doing that. You have to prove to your team, you have to prove to yourself. And the first win he got was the Italian Championships, and that just swung the pendulum because Vinokourov, the team owner, was putting a little bit pressure. I wouldn't say as much pressure as Tinkoff was putting on Peter Sagan this year. But Peter Sagan is back to winning ways, and he looks good. So some people deal with pressure, other people don't. But come the end of the Tour de France last year, you know, Vinokourov was more than happy, but he was putting a lot of pressure on Nibali beforehand, and you know, rightly so in his mind. But in the end, Nibali knew what he was doing and delivered. Whether he would have won the Tour de France if Contador and Froome had been there, nobody knows. So we hope to see a great July of these four contenders battling it out.
Well, we're shooting the breeze about the Tour de France because this has been rock solid, this breakaway, for quite some time. It's just 95 seconds, as you can see, a minute and 35, as they come past one of the aggregate stations here. You get a lot of building materials actually ground out of the ground in those parts of the world where there isn't much agriculture and you've got high mountains. You may as well grind down the mountains and send them off as building materials. So generally speaking, you do see a lot of that kind of excavation. It's a hard man's terrain, this, albeit it looks rather beautiful and soft today, very green. Temperature isn't a softie though, it's around 30 Celsius and still rising. Hottest part of the day today predicted to be at 3 p.m. local time, so in about 35 minutes time, and then it'll just start to ebb a little bit. It's so still, even the helicopter failing to disturb the trees, as you can see from this aerial shot right now. Tinkoff Saxo just tapping it out. There looks to be no hurry at all, but it does rise and fall today. So sort of rolling terrain, no high mountains, we've dealt with those. And of course Contador winning yesterday into Bagne de Luchon, and that's why he's wearing the coveted orange jersey. To my mind, it looks rather groovy. It is a sort of a colour of the moment, really. And I wouldn't be surprised to see if Tinkoff Saxo adopt orange next year as their special Tour de France jersey. They have to wind down the yellow volume for the Tour itself, as no team is permitted to contrast with the leader's yellow jersey. And so it's got it's sort of pale yellow this year. You'll be seeing their special for the Tour de France with what looks like grey camouflage sort of bleeding onto it. Anyway, you'll see. They won't look like this, that's for sure. Last year, previous tours, they've actually been more accented on the blue, which I think also looks rather fetching, but nonetheless, we're just speculating. We'll take ourselves a commercial break, and we'll be back and maybe have a chat about the contenders for that coveted green jersey on the Tour de France in just a few moments' time, as the gap holds at about 140 with 54.5 kilometres to go. Welcome back. Just looking at these pictures, you're probably feeling like sneezing. Yes, it's not harvest time yet, so the crops are in full flower. And if you do suffer with your allergies, as the generic term is, for hay fever amongst riders, then this is probably a bit of a sneezer today. That said, I think this part of the world is not quite in that zone as much as Northern Europe is, so probably suffering more in the low countries than you are down here. Nonetheless, the heads of the crops haven't quite turned, which is why the fields look so beautifully soft, why they're open to abuse from the helicopter. I don't think they ever did shell out compensation, but there were a few fields that were flattened by Tour de France helicopters a couple of years ago, and the Farmers Union did get in touch and say, do you mind packing it in, because it's rather expensive what you're doing, just to get the low-down shot. And occasionally the helicopters do kick up, especially at harvest time, if it does happen to cross over, if they do take an early harvest due to unseasonably hot early part of the season. Then you get a lot of chaff kicked up, and I've seen riders, particularly on sweaty days, looking like scarecrows, let's put it that way, with dust and bits of chaff all over the place. Yeah, it's not comfy either. You've experienced helicopter blast and dust, Brian. It's not pleasant.
No, but then they have to get close to get the shots, and if they get too close, you'll see a lot of the riders waving at them to go away, not to wave at them, to wave them to go away. But you know, the likes of we got a puncture here for Francais de Joux, Moret, so the 34-year-old, rear wheel puncture. So he'll be soon getting that change. We're just going to stay with him and see how fast it takes.
You know, on the approach there, I do worry. Tour of Flanders, Francais de Joux were involved. Oh, hello, and okay, you know, an open door or anything like that.
Well, this is not completely right, because this is the second car that's actually in the front group, and he's on his own. What the UCI are trying to do is have the second sports director with a mechanic in the back, you know, and they're trying to go away from just having one car. This because of the amount of staff required for all the races at this moment in time. So Francais de Joux have obviously come here, the second car, and you just see less bikes on the top of the second car. And with Francais de Joux, he had to come out the driver's door, go into the back of the car, get the wheel, give it up, and that's why a slower puncture. So the UCI are trying to stop that. So every second vehicle has to have two people in that car.
There we are. Well, it's not an absolute top draw event. I don't mean that disrespectfully at all, but nice that Ober or the Maria team helped out there. Just sort of, it looked like he was wrestling through, but actually he was offering up his assistance because his own team were short-handed, as you saw, and so said, look, just get back in, we'll slingshot you onto this little road. Nice and sinuous it is, and good job that we haven't got any rain, because these roads, despite a high crown on these country roads, do muddy up very, very easily. And thankfully, nice and dry. In fact, the weather has been absolutely glorious. We're expecting it to rain yesterday. Didn't happen, and that provided a dry descent, which produced fireworks. You can see there's a lot of sort of low-lying buildings here as well. When the land is not overly pricey, then you can expend your footprint. And of course, very much a Spanish feel to some of the buildings as well, along the way, with 50.4 kilometres to go. Few chops and turns, as you can see, no real attack going on. I think our friends from Francais de Joux will get back in. This is Murray on his own.
It's going to be difficult, Carlton, because the nine riders left in front, they can't take it easy.
No.
Just looking to see where this corner is. Murray has come through, his own team car will come through. This is sharp corner coming up left, and I think he's looking at close to maybe still 30 seconds now.
Well, if it is 30 seconds, it's a lot of pushing, as you can see, in open countryside. Thankfully, at least he hasn't got the wind against him today. We'll see just how much of an effort this takes. He's not got any respite, of course.
Yep,
the cars are trying to help him.
This is a sticky bottle.
Hey, how long will that one last? That is the stickiest bottle I've seen for some time. It may well garner a little bit of a fine. He's just about to get back on the back here of those service cars, so it looks like he's going to make it back in, so good for him. With a little help, and there we are, 29 seconds. You're out by a second.
Oh, I'm sorry for that.
And yet more aggregate for you all to feast your eyes upon.
You have to, you know, you get a commissaire car just pulling over to the left-hand side. I don't mind this at all. He punctured from the breakaway.
Yep.
He should be allowed to be put back. Sticky bottle. behind the car, it's still a bit of energy he has to use to come back to the front group and where he had that mishap in the first place. It's just discretions by the UCI, and if the commissaires are fair, then they would turn a blind eye at this because it's not changing the outcome of the race. But then again, as you rightly said, Carlton, he may have a fine for kind of hanging on to that bottle.
There we are. Lucky for him as well, he sort of it led into a gentle climb, and 49, or just shy of that, kilometres to go, and he's just picking his way through the cars and doing a good job as well. UNCP, any word? Get back in. Yeah, he'll do he is where he wants to be, which is great. Back with those up the road. So less aero import. Well, as soon as they go up and the road kicks up just a little bit, so we get back in fairly shortly. So the gap holding today. It is one of those holding days. We had two of those, Brian, and Contador was talking about the fact that that was the absolute plan. Just spin the legs up, make sure that you're where you need to be for the target day, which was day three. Today it's just about maintaining that jersey and giving the team a victory.
Yeah, it was always about stage three, the overall, but the other interesting factor here, Carlton, is if the Français de Jour rider Morey hadn't have made it back to this front group, because it's in the best interest for him to be there and for this front group for him to be there as well, because that would mean there's another strong team that would want to get something from this stage today. And if he'd have gone backwards, never made it up, then Français de Jour possibly could have come to the front and started to bring this back. So with 1:20, this is controllable, and if Morey hadn't have made it to this group again, then Francais de Jour could have come to the front and brought this group back, and it could have changed the whole dynamics of the stage today.
Here at Tinkoff Saxo, still plying their trade and doing a good job up front. Movistar just staying close at hand. I don't think there's any indication that Quintana thinks he can close the gap overall. It's a modest 17 seconds, but more than good enough to carry Contador to victory with that jersey. Good team performance by Tinkoff Saxo. We talked about the general classification contenders for the Tour de France. Let's talk about the green jersey. We've already mentioned Peter Sagan. He's on great form at the moment. One man who is not is Marcel Kittel. In fact, I think duties may well even fall to Degenkolb within his own team. What's happened to Kittel this year?
Just illness. And you know, when you think of even Mark Cavendish had his trouble, he won so many stages, and you know, he had a year where he didn't do too much, and Kittel was just having a dreadful start of the year. He tries to come back and it's just not there, and unfortunately for the Tour de France, he might not be back in top condition, because we're talking about the major contenders for the general classification. I want to see all the best sprinters there as well, and unfortunately I don't know if Kittel will be the man for Giant Alpecin. As you said, Degenkolb might have to take up the reins.
And you've got to be in good nick early, Brian, because of the way they're distributing the points this year. They're all coming in the first week on the sprinters' days.
And even the first road stage is flat, windy, and you know, he's very capable of winning that, so we just have to kind of wait and see. But it's not happening, and this is what happens if you get a little bit of illness. You try to get over it, and you know, they'll be working hard to get him back. But I don't know what his confidence will be like, because sprinters all go in confidence. And if he's not had the win this year, then he goes into the first stage, and it's going to be very difficult.
Yeah. Thinking about Mark Cavendish, we'll have a chat about him. But what he has said is that tumbling last year, which has sort of knocked his run to beat Eddy Merckx's stage record, has now reignited the passion. Apart from anything else, he believes he's got plenty more to give, and we believe him. Welcome back. Our breakaway is still intact. They've fractured occasionally due to technicals, but they are here. Montaguti, Moray, Mongier, Bishkara, Aldi, also up the road here today. Federico, who from Brenner Session Veramental Alfaraz, Cousin of Europcar, Duarte and Vieira. 10 riders then, and they did wait on just ever so slightly. In fact, gave away about 13 seconds to these guys. Just waiting so that they could reassemble themselves and make sure that life stayed calm, at least in terms of the gap. But it may well change. Francis Moray got himself a puncture. They waited up, got him back in, and here are the pack. Not exactly chasing on at the moment, no desire to do so. Most teams represented in the break, and as a result, they've got no interest in winding it back in. However, Brian, that could change if there are any indications from the men up the road that maybe it's not going to be their day, and that will encourage other teams perhaps to join the fun. Stage winners so far, Trone was very good into Auch, and in fact held the leader's jersey through yesterday. It's gone on to Contador's shoulders right now. He did a brilliant job for over 93. Maybe the efforts that Ober had put into those opening couple of days mean that they're a little second-hand today, but maybe Trone will fancy it. But likewise, some of those other teams, Brian, if their men are seen to be lacking in firepower up front, it may well be that some teams come up and decide to grind it out and go for it.
Well, that's going to happen pretty much in the last 30 kilometres, that they'll get the information at how are you feeling in the breakaway. And if, say, for instance, Kozan, if he's not feeling too good for Europcar, they may decide to ride. He sits on, they start riding in the peloton, bring it back, because I still believe that Koka is the fastest man. They could win two stages. And when you're in a situation like this, you have a big question: how can we win the stage? Can we win it from the breakaway? 10 teams are represented in the breakaway, so 10 separate teams. Six have lost out. Tinkoff, they're just not worried about the breakaway, they're just worried about looking after Contador in the orange jersey. Movistar, I don't think Sands is sprinting too well. They just want to keep Quintana safe. The teams missing out are Auburn 93, Radio Popular, the Army team in Cannondale. The Auburn 93 team have already worn the jersey twice with Trone and got a stage one, so they should be happy enough with that. They're hoping that it'll stay at a minute and a half. Then there's a situation that maybe some teams will come up because they're not too confident of the breakaway rider. But the likes of Kozan, he won Tour of Normandy in 2012. He's a strong enough rider. Give them an opportunity. And then we've got Hardy. If you look at who is the fastest sprinter of this front group, I'd think that Montaguti would be there and thereabouts. Duarte, former under 23 champion for Colombia, looks strong enough. El Fares, for sure, for Marseille, will try and attack. Federico can finish fast. Four stages in the Tour de France, 21 pro wins, so he's delivered in the past. At 36, he's not the youngest, but he's certainly one of the most experienced riders in that breakaway. He's just coming through to do his turn now in the black kit, former French champion, you see on the sleeves. This breakaway of 10 can go to the finish. I don't think all the riders will come to the finish and contest the sprints. So for the last 20 kilometres, we're going to see some interesting racing.
What was interesting earlier on is that Colombia basically told the camera bike to get lost because they were offering up too much assistance and killing off the breakaway. Too much assistance to the team that were leading the charge, Tinkoff Saxo, who are quite content for the time being, I guess, at the gap. It's solid, let's put it that way. Vieira is the big threat at 3:09 of the breakaway. But Duarte is that rider from Team Colombia, and clearly they believe he's got a turn of speed. And if nothing else, amongst those favourites that you've just outlined, Brian, I think Duarte, that the camera is just hoving in on right now, has got a good chance today. His team certainly believe it, and they didn't want this breakaway messing up, which is why they spoke to the camera bike.
Exactly. They've already got the King of the Mountains. That's done and dusty from Martinez. So from the breakaway, it looks as if Magger of Colt Energy, he's at 36 minutes and 22 seconds, the 23-year-old German rider in the breakaway, is sitting at the back of the front group, so obviously suffering a little bit. Just noticed that Quintana, he's really not happy with what's happening in the front of the race with the motorbike, so he's just kind of waving. It's all about, you can just see him being surrounded by his teammates. They want to look after them. They don't want any incident whatsoever. It's the same with Tinkoff. They don't want anything happening. This gap holding just about 1.5 minutes. Still 40 kilometres to go. Still plenty of racing still to come.
That was the camera bike just coming up and trying to get a close-up of the great man himself. And his teammates just mobbing it, almost like security guards coming up and just saying, get the hell out of here.
Well, I think when we were looking at him, the TV camera bike, but also in these races you have photographers as well, and some of them will come back, and you've got the blackboard. So we don't actually see it because the first bike in front of the peloton is in fact a TV bike, but there's a load of other bikes swarming around at the front of the peloton to get their pictures or to get information via the blackboard.
And inevitably, of course, they get it wrong within a tour, and the last thing you want right now, look at other teams as well just saying, look, get out of here, they're going to almost ride right into him. They're having a chat, there we are, and just saying in the politest possible way, or maybe slightly impolite, go away. And indeed they do.
We're seeing it now. There's three in fact bikes. One was just at the Movistar bike there. Normally, and you know, they're given instruction that you can't actually go into the bunch, because as soon as you get into the bunch, then it's you know, safety issues. You have to stay in front of the first rider. Sometimes you'll see them go along beside. But in the peloton, it's not normal that we see filming inside the group.
39.5 kilometres to go, a minute and 28. We promised everyone we'd talk about Mark Cavendish. Came off the bike, of course, last year in Yorkshire. It wasn't the way the script was supposed to be written. However, has recovered brilliantly, had some surgery, of course, to a very nasty disengaged collarbone. But he's back in winning ways. He had a good start to the season in the Middle East, and all of a sudden he is talking up his potential. And of course, as if he needed to do that, we know all about Mark Cavendish. We know about his desire as well to form a place in history. He's a great man who wants that green jersey again, and he believes that this is his he's re-engaged, let's put it that way, and feels like he's starting the second half of his career. It's been a long one, an amazing one. He does keep his desire going longer than I think just about anybody I can think of, to be honest. I find it quite remarkable that he has so much passion still left in the tank after achieving so much, and yet now he's saying that, yeah, he feels reinvigorated by that crash because it made him reconsider. The desire is there, and he's going to go for it. And I'm just, it's great to hear him talking like that ahead of the great race itself. There's none of that, we'll see what might happen. He's going for it.
Well, he's the original boy racer.
That's
I don't
fabulous.
Know if we can call him at that now. Maybe the older boy racer. But he's certainly a lot of racing. He just loves it. Doesn't like being away from it. And this year he started off very early, and you know, he's won a lot of races, but the same could be said about Christoph back to winning. He won a stage of the Tour de Suisse. Cavendish is riding that race. He hasn't had the same opportunity, but I don't think Marco will worry about that. He's concentrating on the Tour de France, and certainly once you've got the boy racer in you, you never lose it, and he's coming back with great enthusiasm. And I just hope that Kittel is back to, you know, a good way. Christoph is looking exceptional this year as well, and Sagan is coming back in Swiss. Bohani, let's not forget about him and the French hopes there. And Bohani looked as if he was climbing okay in the Dauphiné as well.
Yeah.
So I'm not too sure about the green jersey with Cavendish, but certainly Bohani, Sagan, Christoph, they're very capable of battling that out. And you know, when you look at all the major competitions in Tour de France, it's going to be a battle for every one of them. Even the King of the Mountains, we're going to see some battles. It was great to see MTN Quebec's the Tickler, Daniel Tekle-Haminot, taking that jersey, and I'm sure there'll be a lot of competition for any of these jerseys in the Tour de France.
Cannot wait. Brian Smith, of course, general manager of MTN Quebec. Fantastic team, not represented here, but are at the Tour de France, and I believe the Welter you've got again, Brian.
Yes, we have two Grand Tours this year. We've worked hard on it, and I believe if we get a strong enough team to go on two fronts, there was a lot of chat about second division teams, Pro Continental, actually fielding two strong enough teams to do two Grand Tours, because they are depleted in numbers and staff and, you know, everything equipment wise. So it's always very difficult for second division teams to do two Grand Tours, but I believe we can. And I want to prove to everybody that we can do this, because we had one Grand Tour last year, the Vuelta, two this year. Hopefully, if things go well, we should be looking at maybe next year or the year after, looking at possibly going to a World Tour.
There we are. And maybe just having your task diluted, Brian. Mr. Multiphone, when a phone goes off, he's usually scrabbling, almost juggling, trying to find out which one it is that's actually ringing. He's a busy man, is our Brian Smith, and we're very lucky to have him here with us today, and in fact throughout this entire Route du Sud. It's been a great race, and it's a beautiful part of the world, and nice to see as well that we're just coming through some of these rather pleasant little villages along the way. Incidentally, we have been provided with a sort of a crib sheet, really, about the locale. And as we're coming through right now, apparently this area is known for, get this, ancient breeds and slow food philosophy. What that means, I have no idea. All right, I've got a handle on ancient breeds. I'm probably one myself. Get that in before you did, Brian. Unusual beasts is what they're talking about. So a bit like Brian. But slow food philosophy, what on earth is that? I am a Kesselord. No, you're not. How do you know? I don't know, something along those lines. Slow food philosophy. I think what they're trying to say is that they're pretty handy at casseroles. You usually get that when you get to the mountains. This man, of course, will be functioning very well in the mountains. It is Quintana. He wants some protection right now, however. And yesterday, well, maybe he just put something in the bank. I think what he actually put in the bank was safety, quite frankly. When he was going round some of those corners on the descent to Bagne de Luchon, he was not wanting to take any risks unnecessarily. And I think he did the right thing. Contador himself was taking a few more risks because he just got the bit between his teeth and thought, I'm going to win this for my teammates who've done a great job of getting me back to the form where I need to be. He's in the leader's jersey at the moment, but nobody wants to throw away a Grand Tour on an event such as this, with all respect to the Route du Sud.
Yeah, it's a good race. I've ridden this race in the past, and you know, the French riders will take all the risks to do what they have to do, but this has been the scenario right from the start, stage one, where Tinkoff have ridden at the fronts, kept Contador out of trouble. Behind them, Movistar have been there. So this is the scenario of the you know, the first couple of stages, and they want to just control things. Whether they want to bring this break back is another thing. The only person they're worried about in the breakaway is Vieira of Carreal at 3:09, a 27-year-old Portuguese rider that could be moving up in the overall, but it's controlled. 35 kilometres to go, still hanging around 1.5 minutes.
It's a lovely part of the world, sort of gently rolling. Foothills of the Pyrenees. We're on a big loop today. We've come into Gaillac and we're going out and all the way back again. We're on that loop. It's about 79 kilometres in length of the 167 that we're covering today. And as they head into the shade, we'll head into a brief commercial break, and we'll be back with you after this. Welcome back. Taking a few lovely turns in this rolling countryside. Not a great deal of drama about the terrain, I think it's fair to say. But as you can see as well, they're just having to take care, let's put it that way, as the pace is just starting to be cranked up a little bit. It's Caio Rural that are doing most of the pushing. We'll see. That's Roman Aldi at the back for Cofidis. But Caio Rural looked the most lively. Whenever, in fact, Vieira comes to the fore and takes a turn, he's got the most to gain, and he wants that gap to be a little bit bigger. 3:09 he trails overall, so not surprising he puts in the pace. Unfortunately, he's essentially battling these guys. Tinkoff Saxo are not going to have the mickey taken out of them as they go into another of these absolutely beautiful arborea. These trees that just shade what was supposed to be apparently planted to shade marching armies of Napoleon. And I guess when you've got borders with Spain and the like, he was fighting on all fronts. And so you see that these trees are a character of France. They can be a danger, If you get it wrong in a vehicle, then you're going to hit one. And there was a move by the current incumbent in the presidential seat to cut them down, quite frankly, and then replant them a couple of metres further away as a programme. And just silliness, frankly. You know, if the trees are there, just take care, for goodness sake. But apparently it does cause a great deal of injury and hurt, and we've actually seen it on the Tour de France, of course, when one of the French television cars actually veered to avoid T-boning a tree, and in so doing veered across the road, took Flescher out. Of course, Johnny Hoogelander very famously rode with many, many scars after that, and I think he was up for one of the jerseys with the King of the Mountains. He was up for at that time as well. Cut to ribbons, he was.
Yeah, it was. That was a really unfortunate incident. But back to your, as you go through one of these slow corners, back to your slow philosophy. I believe Faisi from the Tour of Turkey has been in contact. So has Tom Douglas. Said he just googled it and is told you to think organic fair trade.
Oh, right, OK. So, thank you. Slow. So, why would that be slow? I don't know, maybe. But Faisi himself, slow food philosophy, says he's one that goes with Turkish raki. Faisi, you're a lovely man. And I do remember fondly the... was it the Shakespeare restaurant?
Yes.
Yeah, right. Where were we that day?
Alanya.
Oh, fantastic. Yes.
Just good thing I'm here.
It is. Well, the raki was strong that night. I can't remember much. I did order some socks. Apparently, Faisi's sorting me out. But anyway, we digress. 31.6 kilometres to go. 1 minute and 27 is our gap. It's absolutely solid at the moment. And Colombia. Well, you know what? Cairo Oral have got an interest today. And clearly, so has Duarte on behalf of Colombia. He wants some pace here. They saw the gap coming down. Unfortunately, the pack have responded. And so all that's happening at the moment is they're putting in more effort, and the pack are just changing the tempo and forcing them to engage even more strength, I'm afraid.
That's all it is in this level of race. No race radio, so solely on the blackboard, and a lot of interest. When you think back to stage one, Trone for Auburn 93 got the stage one, and then Eurocar got it with Kokar. Yesterday was all down to Contador Quintana. Contador Tinkoff came out on top. So the fourth stage and last stage, it's important for a lot of these teams to try and get something from the race. Colombia have the King of the Mountains. That's been sewn up by Martinez, who's on the attack in the first stage. They really want to drive this along. They want this breakaway to work. The only passenger they seem to have is the Cult Energy rider at the back, the 23-year-old German.
I'm looking at the peloton here, and the team that are best placed to reach out and grab today are Europcar. And it will be a heartbreaker, of course. No rider likes to be up front and then have his own team attacking him, essentially. But if they have no belief in Jérôme Cousin, then they'll go for it for Brian Coquart. He did win, of course, into Saint-Gaudens on stage two, and it was emphatic, wasn't it? It was a huge margin that he gained within the last 40 metres.
It was indeed an emphatic win by Coquart. But the thing is, Carlton, right, you get to, say, 25k's to go, right, then you have to make the decision, because the gap is only a minute and a half. And we've seen Europcar struggle to bring the breakaway back that day. Until EG2R came up and helped him out, I think that breakaway would have stayed away. So at that moment in time, when you said that break would stay away, you were correct if no other team came up. But they did, it was EG2R. Just look, if we see in this group in front of the 10 riders in the breakaway, if we see Cousin start to miss turns and sit on the back, that means that he is sitting there because he doesn't believe that he can try and win this stage, that a Europcar possibly will come up to the front and try and bring this breakaway back.
As if by magic, he is kind of sitting there at the moment. He's a bearded gentleman, has a look over his shoulder just to see whether he can actually get back out any further, checking for cameras, I imagine. That is Roman Hardy. Third on the Tour of Turkey, actually, as we were talking of Fizey. That was last year, of course, the 26-year-old for Cofidis. Beautiful blue skies today. Temperatures just starting to ease a little bit. We just nudged to 31.5 Celsius, and it's just coming back off that very intense level of heat. It's a lovely part of the world when the sun does shine. Quite often it does rain. Thankfully, it hasn't during this event, and it's not going to today. We'll finish emblazoned with sun, ever brightening, it seems, the orange jersey, which is on the back of Alberto Contador at the front of the chase. And here is his team right now. Tikhov Saxo in their familiar yellow and blue, and Contador in orange. There he is, as if by magic. Closest to them, Movistar, of course, with Nairo Quintana, who's calling for help and protection from the camera bikes. Contador not quite so troubled by them, but Quintana is. And I just wonder whether that's a display of perhaps a little bit of nervousness or concern ahead of the Tour de France. He wants to protect his run on the great race. And there he is, winner of the Giro d'Italia, of course, last year, and one of the out-and-out favourites for the Tour de France. One of the big four. We talked about the big four, of course, Brian, but let's not forget those who are close at hand, the likes of Romain Bardet, and that would bring great joy to the French if he managed to get on the podium. He's capable.
He looks good. He had a little bit of a fall in the Criterium de Dauphiné. I don't think he was beaten up too much. He has to take confidence from that. But the thing about Bardet is he's willing to put himself out there. He's not one of these kind of controlled riders. And, you know, let's hope that he's given a little bit of freedom and can mix it up. Pino, currently leading the Tour de Suisse at the moment, he's another, outsider. We're talking about the big four, but Pino, Bardet, as you mentioned, Pirro doesn't seem to be on the same form as he was last year. But I'm sure there'll be one or two riders that'll be thrown into the mix come next month.
Maybe some have been a bit quiet. We'll see. But watch out for Bardet. I've got him as an outside bet, and I think he'll go very well. He's certainly, the French have got very, very high expectations of him. We'll see whether he can meet them. Minute and 23 with 27.6 to go, and it looks like the break, at least for the moment, are sustaining their effort, albeit short-handed, and that's that some riders are actually taking a bit of a break, not doing their turn out front. It hasn't really caused too much worriment, and as if to pay everybody back, Francis Dujeux and Francis Moret at the front right now, taking his turn through the little avenues of trees along the way. 27.3 kilometres to go, minute and 32. It's holding, Brian. They are able to take, in a group of 10, they're able to take a decent amount of rest, certainly a lot more than they would if it was a smaller group out front. How fresh do you think these guys are going to be? It's been four tough days, especially coming after the 181 kilometres to Bagnes de Luchon yesterday. 167 today, of which we have 26.9 remaining. And a minute and 31 is the gap. How fresh?
I don't think that any of them are fresh at all. This race is, there's no flat in this area. It's up and down the whole time, some heavy roads. So it's really who wants it the most. And you get Bretan Sesh coming to the front with Federico. They've already lost three riders in this race. Dan McClay, Romain Feillou, and Jonathan Hivert today.
There we are. High attrition then in this race. Probably why we've got a few moments just to get you up to speed on those who have not continued today. We've had plenty of withdrawals and some DNSs as well. Maxime Daniel and Hubert Dupont of AG Tour Le Mondial, not here any longer. Pedersen as well, Mats Pedersen from Cult Energy, decided this was not to be his day, or indeed the remainder of this race. Venturini from Cofidis has gone. Two from Breton Seche Environnemental. That's Harrier and Iver are out of the race now. Lavarnet of Uber 93. Penaven from Marseille 13. Radio Populaire today lost Magalash, who was up there in the break on day two, you may remember, doing some good work as well, was Magalash, and wearing the polka dot jersey that day at the end of it. Cyril Gauthier has has decided that this is not for him, for Team Europe Car. Colombia as well, Molano has stepped off, and Roman Rau of the Land Army, that we haven't seen much of today. So thinned out, I think you might say. Some of those names, or many of those names, are climbers, so today really wasn't going to do much for them. They'd spun themselves in to the big climbing day, which of course yesterday taken by Alberto Contador and the lead of this race. 25 kilometres to go, just less than that right now. We've got a 10-rider breakaway. And still just rolling and staying in touch is Christian Mangier at the back for Colt Energy. The green jersey is here of Roman Audi, but there are plenty who have options on the win today, the stage win, that is. Fabio Duarte of Colombia, his team just telling it at the cameras to get out of town and stop assisting the chase down because they wanted him to have a chance of going for the sprint. Well, he'll have to cope with El Fares from Marseille 13. Roman Ardi as well, the veteran who wears the green points jersey, has assembled plenty of points along the way today. In fact, that jersey looks safe upon his back, but will he go for it? What about Pierre Federigo turning the clock back? Four stage wins on the Tour de France, the 36-year-old. Can he do it? And indeed, what about Monteguti from 82 Alla Mondiale? No disrespect to the other guys who are here, Moray, Mongier, Bisguera, Cousin, Vieira. But it's a quality group of 10 riders. They've got a great chance. They're holding the gap at minute 24. And no team so far has actually decided to drive them into the ground. Not Tinkoff Saxo. They don't need to. The best placed man in this breakaway is Vieira. He's 3 minutes and nine down overall. And so a minute and 22 gap at the finish line will suit Contador and Tinkoff Saxo very well indeed. So what other teams are going to pick it up? Who's going to have a crack? Or is this group going to make it all the way?
Well, it looks as if they've got a very good chance. Colt Energy rider at the back, the 23-year-old German Mager for Colt Energy in the back. He's been sitting on for a considerable amount of time now. Maybe the Colt Energy are not happy with this, and maybe that's a team that might come to the front. Cousin for Europcar has still been doing his turns, so it looks as if they're happy. Europcar don't want to come to the front and commit themselves. They'll just leave it all up to Tinkoff to look after the orange jersey of Contador. And if this stays the same, Vieira in the breakaway at 3:09, if he gains a minute, he pops up in from 11th to 7th place overall. Just getting confirmation over race radio that Patrick Gretsch, the German rider for AG2R, has climbed off as well. Most people, you know, maybe watching at home, doesn't think that maybe this stage doesn't look too difficult. But if you consider the first hour 45.6, second hour 44.3, they have been ticking along here, up and down heavy roads, and you know, the war of attrition is really getting to a lot of these teams, and they're depleted in numbers, and that's why we're still seeing Tinkoff at the front just holding the gap at just you know, a minute and a half or thereabouts.
Strength in numbers, and I guess the strength of the Tinkoff Saxo team being writ large on our screens today. Too many taking a holiday from the nose of this breakaway, I'm afraid. And I think this is going to blow apart, and probably with about 18k to go, I think you might well see this start to get very animated out here. And some of those that have been hanging on, maybe with a valid excuse, maybe will surprise us. We'll wait and see. I'm just waiting to see what Colt Energy's Mangier does. They're clearly working for Carbel, Colt. They'd love to set up Carbel. I think he was the big choice on the day that Trone took it ahead of Audi. Audi's in this breakaway as well, so he can go reasonably quickly out of a group. Carbel, I think, would have been... he looked very good and fresh, the youngster from Colt. He's a big Dane. We'll see. It might well be that Mangier suddenly, when it does start to fracture, and I think it will, suddenly finds his legs, let's put it that way, as part of the breakaway. There'll be a few stares across the dinner table tonight if he suddenly does get very animated. Looks at the camera, flicks his elbow out to the camera. He's not going to help you in that way, mate. They're rocking and rolling, Brian. This doesn't look like a group that's going to make it at least complete to the line. How many do you think might kick off?
I think it'll be all over the place. I think this front group will explode as we get closer towards the line. Still no team coming up to 21 kilometres to go to the finish. No other team really thinking about it. You can just see behind Movistar what's left of the Europcar team in the dark green are having a think about it. They've all moved up towards the front, having a think if they have to come to the front to bring it all back for the sprint for Kokar. But they're leaving it all up to Tinkoff driving at the front in this front group. The green jersey of Roman Hardy, second and fourth on the stage already, and that's why he's got the green jersey on. On paper, he will be the fastest, but everybody knows that they don't want to bring him towards the finish. Federico, four stages in Tour de France, very astute, intelligent bike rider. But everybody's just kind of eased ever so slightly back. We've just gone through the 20 kilometre to go. Everybody will see that. Everybody thinks in this front group they're in with a chance of a stage win now. And you just see the pace at the front group is not being driven on.
It's not being driven on. Minute 11 with 20.4 kilometres to go. Europcar messed it up on day one to Auch. That was 204 kilometres. They did a lot of the pushing. They managed to tee up a sprint, but unfortunately faded at the very end. They made amends for it on day two when Kokar took an emphatic win, cut it very, very fine. It's all about timing. So will Europcar get it right today? They've got 20 kilometres to sort out this breakaway. Unfortunately for them, a lot of talent on board. They've got a man in the break, I'll remind you. However, Jérôme Cousin possibly not got the beating of everybody else here. Some really proper sprinting talent amongst the breakaway, and he wouldn't be the top draw or on the top shelf of the 10 who are up the road. So will Europcar suddenly decide to change the pace and go for it? Right now they're leaning on everyone else around them. Everyone else lent on Europcar on day one. They don't want to get bitten again, Brian.
Yeah, it looks like that's they've got their stage one, and what an effort they put on stage one. Never got anything from it. Came out emphatically one with Kokar, albeit with some help of AG2R towards the end. Yesterday wasn't a day for them, but today Kokar is his name written all over the stage, but by putting a rider in the break. They're leaving it late, still just over a minute's advantage, and Europcar can come towards the front and bring it all back for a sprint. But then again, sprints, you know, anything can happen, and you know, we've seen it happen before with crashes or anything. So they believe they want to give Cousin an opportunity now, but the racing is going to start with an earnest as we get close to the 10 kilometres to go.
Indeed. kilometres to go, a minute and 14. It's absolutely solid for the time being. It's been just drifting and ebbing and flowing just by a couple of seconds for quite some time. What's that man got left? I'd be fascinated. If he comes out and starts bullying them, there'll be words, stares, visual daggers. Let's put it that way. Minute 15 then, with 17.6 to go. When are they going to believe, Brian?
It's still hanging in the balance for me. It's possibly they have to keep riding. They've got a passenger on the back. You can just see the way they're riding at the front of the peloton. They're not really driving it, which means that the front of the race is not really driving. I think it's just a calm before the storm, and the breakaway are just waiting to start attacking each other.
Yeah, when you see a man itching his nose, having what to me looks like not a gel bar, but something a little bit more sustaining on a day like this. You get all kinds of stuff, incidentally, in your feedbacks that you can enjoy. And look at this, we've got a little bit of ambition just being displayed right now with Aubert coming to the fore. This is for Trone, who took the orange jersey on day one with a great victory into Auch. I think he fancies it again.
Well, you have to put them in with a chance. 17 kilometres ago, now we're starting to see some of the teams that have missed out in this breakaway start to move themselves up. Are they thinking about it? Do you think they've got the firepower to be able to deliver? The teams that have missed the breakaway, apart from the World Tour teams of Tinkoff and Movistar, are Auburn 93, Radio Popular, the Army team, and Cannondale Garmin.
Who's your pick for 82 Le Mondial if they join? Is it going to be Juregui again?
He had a very good finish. They've lost a couple of riders today, but I would think that Juregui would be their fastest sprinter that they've got.
Mm. Well, they helped out Europcar on that day that Coquart finished as victor. Juregui was up there, although faded rather quickly as Coquart just powered away. Best sprinter here is Coquart, but he's not in the breakaway. But his teammate is up here, and that is Jérôme Cousin. He's not a sprinter, and he's surrounded by some who are. That Colombian there, I think, is the big danger. Wearing the black with the yellow sash across his back is Fabio Duarte. King of the Mountains in Luxembourg. Yeah, I know, not many mountains in Luxembourg, but former under-23 world champion. And so, yeah, I think he's got a big option today. Likewise, El Fares for Team Marseille 13 in the blue. So yeah, can go quickly when he needs to. Still question mark on Federico, but only because it says number 36 next to how old are you. But four stage wins on the Tour de France. Don't discount the man from Betoncesh, Environnemental, in the dark black and green, number 73. There he is, just up towards the front, P5. And Aubert do want it. They are now engaged in the chase, albeit on one of the inclines. Minute and 21, it had drifted out. Will Europcar come and work with Aubert? Europcar suddenly just show themselves on the side of the road, right-hand side as we look at it, but left-hand side for them. AG2 Le Mondial also coming up. 15.9, minute and 23. Have they left it too late?
Yeah, I don't think they've got the firepower. It's just to put two riders up there. You can just see Sergio Paulino just move to the side and said, well, if you want to ride, we've been riding for the last few days, come up and ride. But you just see he's pushing a big gear, puffing and blowing. It's going to be very difficult for two riders from Auburn 93, a third division team, to bring this gap back. If I was in this front group, I would be worried about the green jersey at the back. He's sitting and trying to hide behind the Colt Energy rider, trying to save a little bit of energy, and he's already got second and fourth in a stage already. Federico knows that this is an opportunity for Betoncesh, who's coming through to do his turn. The most experienced rider in the breakaway in the black and the green helmet. Vieira is just riding for time. He wants to go into the top 10. He's sitting 11th at the moment. But the big danger for me is the green jersey trying to hide at the back.
There we are. Will he break their hearts? We'll see. Roman Ardi of Cofidis normally wears red, but he's got the green points jersey, and that's because he's been up there or thereabouts on both of the sprinting days. He was second behind Tronet on the run into Auch, and then he was fourth behind an absolute powerhouse of Coquart. And so he's in a great place at the moment. He's also been hoovering up intermediate points along the way. And I think that green jersey looks like it may well belong to him, and we'll see. He's got to finish today, so let's hope for a clean finish. Let's talk about the run-in, Brian, because we'll be there before you know it, and it's ever-increasingly looking like these guys have got the heart to do it, because, frankly, the heart for a chase doesn't appear to have come to the fore, at least in the pack as we stand. There are a couple of 90 degrees on the approach.
Yeah, with 3 kilometres to go coming in, we've got a left-hander with a K and a half to go, and then another right-hander with 528 metres to go to the finishing line, and then it's pretty much straight all the way in. But again, yeah, it's still touch and go. I don't think that just Auburn 93, with a little bit of help from Tinkoff, will bring this 10-man group back. And the danger man for Tinkoff is well in control. He sits 3:09, so they've got 2 minutes to less than an advantage to Vieira for Caruau. But it's all about the stage. I believe that the breakaway can stay away and take the stage win. That's not saying that if any other teams come up to the front and start riding, but I don't believe that Auburn 93, with only one rider now to the front of the peloton, can bring them back.
Rule of thumb normally is a minute for 10 kilometres. They don't have that at the moment. They've got a minute and eight with 14 to go. But the firepower in the breakaway and the fact that they are 10 men and they've been able to share the workload is in their favour. Just under 14Ks to go then, and a minute and seven is the gap, and we're on the approach right now. It does flatten out, Brian. In fact, the run today sort of ebbs and flows downhill ever so slightly, and they're on a little downhill ramp right now, so they can take a little bit of respite on the way in.
The thing about this, Carlton, is they are not, the front group is not driving along. Okay, it's been a fast stage. You know, they're averaging about 45 kilometres an hour for today's stage. It's just not been easy. It's been up and down. It's the temperatures are, you know, been just hovering around 30 degrees. But they aren't driving it along. It's the calm before the storm, as we've said. They're just waiting for their attacks to start. There's no way that all 10 riders will come to the finish together, so they're just waiting. And, you know, with 13 kilometres to go, the gap is coming down. I don't think that Tinkoff or Movistar wants to bring these 10 riders back, because it means that a bunch finish is a little bit more dangerous for the likes of Contador and Quintana. So they just want to keep them out there. They just want to make sure that they don't lose over 3 minutes to Vaiella of Caja Rural and lose that jersey. So they're just controlling it and allowing the 10 riders to battle it out in front.
Well, Aubert, as you can see, have decided that this is not the game that they can engage with. Aubert 93, I think they put two on the front. They basically ran out of steam very quickly. And it's Tinkoff Saxo who've now just come up. Yeah, I think you're right. I think they're going to just police their Grand Tour contenders. And, of course, the Tour de France men of Contador and Quintana. And, of course, all their other personnel who are here as support, and many of whom will make up the team later on. That was a nasty little turn, yes, without a penalty turn that they got through safely there. You saw some others struggling. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised if somebody did actually clatter that piece of elevated concrete. They got by it, but that rights large the dangers that they face, Brian, and nobody wants to compromise the Tour de France on a day like this, and that's what we're seeing. It's absolutely solid at a minute. It's going to be the breakaway, isn't it?
Yeah, looking more like it because Aubert 93 tried to come to the front, but none of the other teams that had missed out in the breakaway, and that includes Radio Popular, the Army team, and Cannondale came to the front to help. So I think it's all over for the peloton as the 10 riders in front will try and battle out for the stage win.
Yeah, and significantly, they've still got some power in their legs, the men out front. You saw them actually resting up, knowing that this is holding it just about, just over a minute. Aubert still trying to put something in. Their director sportif saying, come on, we've had the jersey, this is your last big day, bury yourselves. And finally, RD comes and does a turn out front. It's going to be fireworks. Welcome back. Minute and one. Yeah, 8 seconds difference from when we went to the break. 10 kilometres. Well, you need a minute if you've got 10K. That means it's touch and go. It means it's a possibility. Well, are they chasing? The answer is they're thinking about it. Have they left it too late? It's a question of timing if you want to catch a breakaway. And right now, there are plenty of teams that are starting to mass at the front who are thinking about helping out the chase down. Have they got what it takes? It's 59 seconds now with 9.7 to go. It's going to be touch and go. This is exactly the scenario we had into Saint-Gaudens. Europcar managed the situation well then, in partnership with the AG2R Le Mondial. Big straight road, and they're going to have sight, as you can see, of those up the road. Will they suddenly turn it on? The power, that is. Somebody's going to have to. Well, Cannondale, Garmin have decided that they may have an interest, and in fact here they are on the front. Sherping is the man that they're thinking about, and suddenly there's a big change of pace. Cannondale, Garmin have decided that they are going to do the driving. Aubert have bedded in. Trone took the sprint into Auch when Europcar got it wrong. AG2R Le Mondial there in the brown and white, also part of the fun. Staying out of the wind for the time being are the team with the best sprinter, Brian Coquard. These guys must start to get nervous. And Roman Ardi, who's looking for stage win today, has decided to do a big old turn out front. Interestingly enough, don't know whether he's just messing it up or messing around. It is the Europcar rider who's in the breakaway who's decided to have a look and indeed kick off right now, and it's starting just to happen.
We've just seen the blackboard being shown to the riders in front. They know that the gap is going to start coming down, so they have to start riding together or start. You can just see the Cult Energy rider shaking his head. He doesn't want to ride, coming down all the time. And, you know, we did say there were six teams missed out in a breakaway. Would they come to the front? Would they drag Coquard to the finish and risk not winning? But it does look as if the World Tour team of Cannondale Garmin may make the difference today, because Aubert 93, the team team of Trone came to the front. It wasn't coming down quick enough. Now we have got Cannondale. They have come up. They only started this race with six riders. They still have these six riders. They're very capable of bringing this 10-rider group back. But just see, riders starting to sit on. Are we going to see an attack in the last 8 kilometres?
Wow. Touch and go, you might say. A rider, Ejidar, with his very loose chin strap. begs the question as to how effective that helmet would be after the first touch, if he did take a tumble. Well, I've seen him come off the bike and it stayed where it needs to be, but it's about comfort, clearly, for him. It's not a comfortable situation for rider Ejidal at the moment. He's driving it on. He's got good support as well here, but it's all for Sherping. Nathan Brown, the American, Ted King's in here as well. Lassie Norman Hansen, good powerhouse. David Vieira as well. They're handy as a unit, Cannondale, and they're showing it right now. Well, are they just doing a favour for other teams along the way? We'll see. Colombia's chosen sprinter is Leonardo Duque. He's not in the break, but his teammate is, and is capable of doing a decent job as well. That's Duarte. But with this gap coming down to 40 seconds now, with 7.4 kilometres to go, and others are starting to play a part, Brian.
Yeah, you got Radio Popular, the team in the black with the light blue and the checkers on the cuffs. So they've started to ride. 39 seconds now, 7. It does look as if this could be coming back together. And just see the Francais de Duque car coming up. They're trying to get that information up to the front of this race to say that these teams are riding, because no race radios. It's going into the team cars. So the Francais de Duque car is trying desperately to go up to tell Mori, it's now or never. They have to drive this on or start attacking this group and get in a smaller group, because it does look as if this gap is coming down all the time.
Monteguti it is for AG Tour Le Mondial, number 17 at the front, wearing the brown and white. He wants a part of the day. He's capable as well, the 31-year-old Italian. Runner-up in the Camiori last year. He'd like a bit more success this time by. And they regroup, but with 36 seconds and 6.4 kilometres, unless somebody really does go on the attack, has what it takes. And Ardi's checking over his shoulder. The man in the green points leader's jersey looks very lively. Everybody else is monitoring him at the moment. It's clear that El Farez as well, from Marseille 13 in the pale blue and white. And here come the Land Army. Nobody up there. They want to help out to at least give themselves a chance of featuring at the end of the day. 33 seconds, 6.1 kilometres to go. It's not over this.
No, it's still touch and go all the way into the finish. It's how much resistance are the 10 riders going to put up? Are they going to combine together? Because they Cannondale are starting to ride. The Radio Popular guys are trying to get involved. Auburn 93 have disappeared, and Tinkoff are not really worried about this. Movistar not really worried about that. They're just trying to keep Contador and Quintana towards the front. Now that Cannondale have disappeared from the front, Radio Popular have got one rider. I think the pendulum is start swaying back to this 10-man group now.
Auburn 93 with Trone. Will he pop up at the end? And suddenly the green jersey of Roman Ardi comes to the fore. Kairo Raul, who also picked it up earlier on. They were the first to inject the pace. It was Ricardo Vieira. And there it is. Oh, it's no gap at all. No gap at all. They're well within sight. And I think this breakaway either has to engage all of a sudden and go for this. It doesn't even look like 26 seconds to me as they come by this line of trees. Not quite an avenue. And they're still checking over their shoulders to see who's going to assist. And there are riders prepared to take it up and respond to any elbows that are flicked down here.
Yeah, just seeing the left-hand side, the camouflage kit of the Army team trying to come up. But it's the team of Trone, Auburn 93, trying to ride this down. But Basso right behind, Movistar in there. They're not going to drive this along. Coming down to 22 seconds. How much resistance has the 10 riders in front? Because this is looking very likely now that it could be a bunch finish.
Well, their attack point, first of them, is as soon as they go out of view in a few moments' time, just a little turnaround. I think they've got a roundabout to hit in this little village. It's a left-right. That would be a great time to go for it, because it'll thin down this bunch and will be compressed. They're checking over their shoulders. Nobody really wants to pick it up just yet. Most focused, Francis Desjeux. Well, we'll see. Here we go, little sleeping policemen to introduce them to this tiny little shimmy. They'll be out of sight right now. There's the left and the right. It is a little roundabout, so map correct. And guess what? Colombia is Duarte that picks up the pace at that point. He goes away. Anyone else going to follow him as they come into Montar? 4.2 kilometres, 14 seconds only, and he's decided at least to try and engage. He's not dragged anyone with him. He can't do that on his own, surely.
Yeah, head down now for Duarte. Just looks behind. He has to go for it. It's only 13 seconds. Both Quintana and Contador's team at the front of the peloton, so the chase is off ever so slightly. As I said before, I'm not too sure that both of their teams will want to bring back these riders. They don't want to get into the melee and the dangerous conditions of a bunch finish, and now the attacks have started to happen in the front group, and it's Duarte going for it.
Well, that's why his teammates were so concerned about any assistance being offered erroneously by camera bikes. They told the bikes off. They told them to get the hell out of there. They didn't want this break to be caught, and this is the reason writ large on your screen right now. It's Duarte. He's got some mountain legs on him as well. He's also pacey, and he picks it up on this little rise. 3.4 to go. 14 seconds is all he has. Have they timed it brilliantly, or have these guys in the break at least given up? And I think it looks like they may well have done. The chase is going to catch them, and in fact, they're just going to ride into shot right now. The pack, the camera's waiting for them on the helicopter, and waiting, and here they come. And it's a big colour option, as you can see. The Land Army are there. Europcar still believe that they've got the drive to make this. They're on the right-hand side of the road. They drift over to that point, and still Duarte holds it for now. Oh, it's a late push is going on. Marseille not part of proceedings right now. And in fact, I think this is just about done and dusted. Arnie doesn't look as though he wants this. The green jersey is there. They still rock and roll with it just a little bit. Montaguti kicks, but to no avail. And I think this is going to be our bunch sprint finish by the end today.
It's still touch and go. Duarte going for it. He's got the Murias rider trying to come up to him. Biscara, the 25-year-old Spanish rider. It's Movistar just not driving it, just keeping Quintana out of trouble. Still a lot of attacks in the front. Kozan comes up for Europcar, and that's why Europcar have decided not to ride. Kozan, a strong rider, but he's only got about 100 metres in the peloton.
Yeah, Kozan then, he's offering up a great excuse for Europcar to keep their powder dry. They don't have to help out in the chase down. It will be a long shot for him, 2.3 kilometres. 2,200 metres about to click down, and I'm afraid that Duarte wasn't to be for him. So, will it be the top draw sprinters from this event? Brian Cocar up against Duque at the end. Well, Trone has decided that he may well have to engage by himself. He's used his teammates for Ober 93 in the blue, and he's very much up towards the fore right now. So Land Army is that's driving on, and ominously for everybody, it is Europcar who are there, and they've got their chosen one, Brian Cocar, who's got an amazing turn of pace when he needs it. Close at hand, just Tulik just in front of him, and in fact it's Bernardo who's doing much of their pacing just now. Staying safe, of course, Movistar and Tinkoff Saxo with Contador in the orange jersey. He's not going to be up there and risk anything, and 1.5 kilometres to go, 1,500 metres. We're going to take a couple of turns. There is a big 90-degree left-hander followed by a right to the line. It comes out with, about 628 kilometres to go from the line. And here come Colombia. This, of course, is for Duarte. They want to be in a decent position, and I'm not surprised.
Yeah, a lot of teams pushing and shoving to get to the front. This is dangerous for the GC contenders. Michael Rogers looking after the orange jersey of Contador, but the Army team coming up the left-hand side, but just behind. You can just see the dark green of the Europcar team as we enter the last kilometre.
There we are, Flamme Rouge, not writ large, but a couple of inflatable pillars, it seems. Well, somebody's going to have to do a Samson today, I'm afraid, and push those apart and push their way through. And here they come. They're all suddenly engaged. Malzahn is here, Raoul as well, for Francis Jeux, making their way up. And here comes Trone. Oh, but not finished just yet. Europcar, likewise, 600 metres to go. Oh, the favourite has to be Cocar. Is he going to be beaten today? Well, Trone will have an option at least on it. Likewise, Francis Jeux, some elbows going on. Lots of shoulder work, I'm afraid. But right now, it looks like Cocar has got this one out. Absolutely wrapped up. A little bit of a hamper for Duque, I'm afraid, on this turn. Oh, this was the type of turn that Trone thrived on last time by. And he's in the frame, Trone, still, as they weave and dive
but it's going to be Coquard. 75 metres to go. He decides that he's going to have to go on his own, I'm afraid. Duque tries to stay in touch. It's not going to be anybody else but that man. Well, he went. They absolutely timed that beautifully. And in fact, who else could there be in the frame at the end with Europe Car finally, well, yet again, I should say, controlling matters. Chapeau to them.
Yeah, another win for Coquard and Europe Car. Left it late in the end, and courtesy of having a rider in the breakaway, didn't have to do any work whatsoever. To say brought as a bit of a present to Coquard. Okay, they had to come to the front just outside the last kilometer and deliver Coquard to the perfect place, but unlike stage one where they rode all day and got nothing, they did nothing today apart from getting a rider in a breakaway and delivered Coquard perfectly. And just see coming up to the final corner here, looks like Sands is up there for a Movistar, Duque coming up the inside for Colombia. But this time, the Eurocar still had a rider in front of him, but coming into this last curve, and it was all about this man, Coquard. Just kicks from the front. You see the back wheel kind of bouncing around a little, just distancing everybody behind him. Looked as if Tronny was coming up then there into fourth place.
Good work. In fact, that squeeze at the end there, they really did have to veer, but that man always had his target in sight and did a great job. His team, absolutely superb. A lot of street furniture here with no brave pennant man on hand, but at least they were warned and the lamppost well padded. Good pace by Brian Coquard, good timing as well. And yet again, he's able to cruise across the line, just engages the power when he needs to and delivers. Two stage wins. Out and out favourite for all of the sprints. He managed to deliver two of them out of the three. Almost embarrassed, I think, on stage one that they got their timing wrong. Two other stages, though, they have delivered. I guess you might say good practice ahead of the Tour de France. Coquard will have some sterling opposition there, though. Brian, good race this. It's kind of done a job, really, I think, for everybody. GC contenders and sprinters alike, they found out a lot about themselves, but and also kept their hand in, essentially.
Yeah, it's been a nice race. It's a nice part of the world. It was a battle here to get into these final couple of corners. Very difficult with this left-hander, and then another kind of right-hander in towards the finish. And I thought the 10 riders had a great opportunity of staying away, but they didn't combine well enough together in the end. And it was Eurocar that was pretty much gifted with doing not too much work today and having the energy to deliver their sprinter Coquard to the line. So two stage wins for Eurocar, they'll be happy with that. Contador gets a stage one and takes the overall victory. And Quintana, just coming back after injury, must be happy with that. You just see Contador now in the finishing straight, so he's safely in that main peloton. But it just gives the opportunity to some of these third division teams to try and get a good result in the top 10.
Enjoyed it, really have, and hope you have too at home. Well, we're here, we may well stay for the podium, and incidentally, we might have a hear a word from Monsieur Coquard as well. It looks warm, it is warm. 32 Celsius, the thermometer says, and the baked terracotta roofs, this beautiful part of the world. Gaillac, incidentally, is where we are. This is the Bastide de Vignoble de Gaillac. We're just having a look at the last kilometer. It was always going to be Europe Car within the frame, and we just wondered, Brian, as to whether they got their timing right, but in the end that's exactly what they did.
Oh, it was perfect in the end for them. You can just see just sitting behind the French army team, there was at that stage two riders inside the last kilometer for Brian Coquard. A lot of riders trying to come up very late. The GC was over by then. Any accidents or anything at all in the last 3 kilometres, they would be given the same time. It was a tricky finish, and it was all important to get into the last phase of the corner. So up this slight incline into the town with 500 metres to go, Sands for Movistar was involved there, but said a tricky finish, Blaine up there for the Marseille team, but a lot of them just backing off this corner. And Coquart had the perfect line. He just accelerated into this last corner, the right-hander. And with a very short finish in straights, there was only going to be one outcome, and that was Coquart winning this stage.
Was a hit that Duque may have just overcooked it going into the corner, that left-hander, that last one. But it got through finally, safely, or the penultimate, I should say. So we have a second stage win for Coquart, and as you saw, the orange jersey of Contador just exchanging handshakes with his team after taking the win. Gorgeous day to pick up your bike and go for it, and that's exactly what Europe Cup did. So let's check out how they finished today. Coquart leading them in. Lorenzo Malzin for Francis Agier. Duque, who got very lively at the end, as you saw, finishing in third place. Troné, good effort by him, you know. He wore the leader's jersey for a couple of days after that victory on Inter Auch. And I'm pleased for him that he yet again showed that that wasn't just a flash in the pan. Finishing fourth today, ahead of Tulik Sans. Verhelst for Cofidis it was, with Duval Fonseca and Maldonado. Well, our winner is, of course, Alberto Contador. Safe job by them today, Tinkoff Saxo, that is. And you saw Movistar as well. Quintana, once again, just shadowing Contador. And I guess that's a form of practice in itself. You can see Contador's orange jersey. In fact, he's about to position 25 at this point when all hell was breaking loose. There's Duque just coming up and almost dive-bombing up the inside. He was... that could have been a sticky moment, to be honest.
Yeah, the gap was open, and in these circumstances, it's a fraction of a second. You have to think about this. But watch the Francais de Joux rider, Malzin. He comes up very, very quickly and just goes through a very, very small gap and takes second place there, and has to check himself away from the photographers.
He does. In fact, he's been declared a second, but I'm actually not sure whether he'll be demoted to third. He's a bigger rider with a bigger frame, but bodily he seemed to come home in third, but it may well have been the nosed ahead. No doubt about the winner, though. Coquart. Well, we've got a bit of time today before we head off to do some motocrossing. And we're just waiting for Brian to have a word with us and just get himself changed and toweled down. And so I understand we may well see a little bit of highlights of the stage. Well, the highlight was frankly the last kilometre. And sadly, it seems that there is nobody with a microphone near Monsieur Coquart. Not a Eurosport issue, I hasten to add. We're at the mercy of our local providers here at the Route de Sud in Gaillac. Brian, you spent a lot of time in this part of the world. I'm not surprised. It's kind of a great place to sort of bake yourself into. I don't know where that phrase came from. Tee yourself up properly for the Tour de France. There's certainly less pleasant places in which to ride your bike on.
No, it's nice. At the start of the year, it's obviously you still get a bit of rain. You get some snow in the mountains, and it's it's hard. But this time of year, perfect conditions, perfect racing, and a great stage finish today.
So, Brian, what's it going to be tonight? We're shooting the breeze at the moment, waiting for the podiums. Is it going to be Duck Cassoulet for you, do you think?
I'm going to go for a slow casserole, I think, dish.
Yeah, duck?
No, it's just the way I'm sitting.
This was your day. It was about policing duties for Contador and Quintana. We had a 10 rider breakaway that headed off up the road. Slight sticky moment for Francis Moret, managed to get himself back in, courtesy of a sticky bottle as well. Everyone turning a blind eye. The breakaway deserved to have its chance. Well, the chase wasn't exactly overly focused, being led by Tinkoff and Saxo. They just wanted to keep within range Ricardo Vieira, who was in the break. And in the end, it was perfect timing as far as Europcar were concerned. For the second time out of the third time of asking, they delivered. Kokar taking his second stage win of this race, and Contador taking the title. Here's your overall classification. Alberto Contador takes this ahead of Quintana. The margin 17 seconds. He established that in the run downhill to Bagnères de Luchon yesterday. He takes the orange jersey, the title here. Pierre Roger Latour, who was so brave to stay in touch with the two main contenders of this race, finishing in third place. Everybody else around about a minute and more down by the end. Four stages, Brian. Coming as it does, it was always going to be a way of measuring your form ahead of the Tour de France, a chance for some small teams as well to have their fun. But all in all, a good race.
I thought you were talking to the stage winner there, sorry. courtesy of the same name. But yes, it shows us something. I don't think it shows us all. It does show that Contador and Quintana are back. And I wouldn't say they're ripping this field apart yesterday's stage. Coca with the sprints here. I don't know if he's going to the Tour or not going to the Tour, but I would expect after a couple of stage wins, we'll just have to kind of wait and see where they go and what Europcar do select. But he's put himself in right in the frame here, and he could surprise a couple in the Tour de France. So, but it's been a good race, well looked at, a lot of spectators, and a tough ride for Tinkoff. They've pretty much ridden from day one on the front to deliver Contador for the win, so they have to go away really happy, doing a fantastic job.
Yeah, all credit to Mick Rogers, actually. He's done, I'm not suggesting he's done all of the work for his team. They shared the duty, but Mick, as you saw today, just puffing out the old cheeks late on, as if to badge up the fact that, yeah, he'd done a lot of work out there. Contador certainly appreciated that yesterday, went for the win, and of course, got that jersey. Well, they're still calling them across the line, and for the time being, we haven't got our podium, so we were hoping to at least show Contador in his bright orange, being bright orange jersey being pulled on as the winner. Brian Coquart, his name is being announced by Monsieur Monjas, who is a famous voice of the Tour de France. He declared, had Daniel, I'm being reminded, declared his retirement last year, but he's still very busy. he can't give it up. It's a bit like that, Brian. Cycling is intoxicating, and there's nowhere better to find it.
No, not at all. And he's been the voice of France, really, in any commentaries that, over the, even Tour de France, when I was a boy, you can hear him in the background, and, fantastic still around, and plenty of experience and enthusiasm.
Yeah, he's great. Monsieur Monjas will be, I think, potentially with us again on the Tour de France. He may well have backed out of that race, but he did declare his retirement, but obviously prematurely. So we have our stage winner, and he's just coming towards the podium right now, and I think we might have the joy of seeing him raising his arm. Oh, and in fact, it's Contador as well, also being announced. Well, you can hear from the applause that this is already going on. Let's have a look at it, shall we? There is Brian Coquart, takes a second stage win on this Route du Sud. And I suggest we may well be seeing more of him. He does have a strange resemblance to André Greipel about it. But there you go, albeit shorter of stature. But yes, visage, a little bit of a similarity there. Maybe I'm just overreading into it, but wide
blonde hair.
I think it's the wide mouth. There we are. And the killer stare when he needs it. There we go. So Kukar taking his second stage win, and again, just confirmation of it for you in case you missed it. Kukar, Manzin and Duque of Colombia. Manzin did get his nose ahead at the line. Well, we've got motocross coming up for you fairly shortly here on Eurosport, but we are waiting for Mr. Contador to come and collect his orange jersey. Alberto Contador. He took the Vuelta last year. He took the Giro out to the top of this year. Will he take the Tour de France? Not sure. But he's taken the Route du Sud on his road. He likes success. He likes the flowers and the kisses. He kind of gets used to it. A lot of success for him. Quintana, nearest man to him. Will it be that way or reversed? Or indeed, will Froome take the victory or Nibali get involved? You're going to have to wait and see on your home of cycling, Eurosport. For now, we'll take our leave from me, Carlton Kirby, and from Brian Smith. Thanks for your company. Our congratulations to Alberto Contador, the man in orange. Will it be the man in yellow by the time we get to the Champs-Élysées? Well, you'll have to tune in and find out, will you not? Contador takes it then. 17 seconds the margin over Quintana. Latour. Great result for Pierre Rogier of AG2 Le Mondial, finishing on the podium ahead of Rosetto and Zeppel Vela, rounding out the top five. That rounds up us off as well. Thanks for your company. My name's Carlton Kirby. Alongside me, Brian Smith. And we bid you farewell.